oxygen, my very breath, the source of life, the source of rest. Oh, I need you. You're the wind that fills these fragile sails. You carry me through crashing waves.
Today, a little bit about this idea of our experience with Christ. Many times we talk about this idea that, what we experience is really the thing that is important, and it is valuable and it is significant. But Scripture also points out that, you know what? As significant as our experiences are with God, our interactions are with God, the thing that we find most important is the things that are written through Scripture. We know that Christ is the Word incarnate, or Word in the flesh, and we know Scripture is the Word of God in, for us, print form. Let me show you how I kind of pull that together. It comes out of 2 Peter chapter 1, starting at verse 16. He says, "We did not follow cleverly devised myths when we made known to you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ." In other words, he was counteracting people who were making up stories, basically, about Christ. And he said, we didn't make up stories about the coming of Christ. And here, I think he not only is talking about Christ coming the first time, but he's also beginning to think about Christ returning for a second time. And he says, we didn't make these up because we have been eyewitnesses to his majesty. For he received honor and glory from God the Father when the voice was conveyed to him by the majestic glory, saying, this is my Son, beloved, with whom I am well pleased. We ourselves heard this voice from heaven while we were with him on the holy mountain. So Peter is referring back to the transfiguration when he went up the mountain with Jesus and James and John, and Jesus was transfigured before him into dazzling whites, and Moses and Elijah was there with him, and then God speaks these words. Think about that. That was a significant experience that he would never forget. Of all of our experiences of experiencing God, you could easily say Peter had the most impactful, the most significant, the biggest, the most glorious kind of experience with God that any of us could ever imagine. And he's saying, we were witnesses to this. And then check the next verse out. In verse 19, he says, so we have a prophetic message more fully confirmed. You will do well to pay attention to this, to the lamp shining in the dark place until the day dawns and the morning star arises in your heart. What is he talking about there? He's talking about, because of his experience on the mountain and seeing Jesus transfigured, he's saying the prophetic message, the written word, is confirmed. The things that the prophets have said through the Old Testament were more significant. They meant more to him. And I think what he says then, he says this, you do well to pay attention to this. Pay attention to the written word, because it's a light shining in the dark place. You know, we hear Scripture elsewhere saying, the word of God is a lamp unto our feet. It's the same kind of metaphor that I think Peter is playing with. And if you back up a little bit, what did he say about the mountaintop experience? It wasn't the fact that Jesus was transfigured or Moses or Elijah was there. It was the voice. It was the voice of God speaking. That's what stood out to him. And that's what is speaking in the Scriptures. If you continue reading in this chapter, he talks about this idea of all prophecy is not a matter of our interpretation because it comes from God. He's tying it back to God's voice. And so what he's saying is the things that we read in Scripture are powerful for us. Our experiences have their place, but they have to be grounded in Scripture. I think that's a great word for us today. Because in a world today that values experience sometimes over truth, we have to be grounded in something that we know is sure, and that is God's Word. Our experiences will come and go. They will fade over time in our memories. But the Word of God doesn't change. And that is our call, to be people of the Word, to ground ourselves, to be encouraged, to be challenged, to be rebuked by the Word. That is the good stuff that God provides for us, knowing that at some point, Jesus will be revealed as he was on the mountaintop in all of his dazzling glory that Peter and James and John saw. We'll see that sometime. And we will have experiences of our interaction with God through the Holy Spirit, for sure. But they have to be grounded in God's Word. So as we are in this season of Lent, I invite you to read Scripture, even as I talked about last Sunday, to read it for spiritual transformation. Just read it a little bit slower. Let the words wash over you. And ask God to let those words find a place in your heart to take root. I invite you to do that today. Lord, thank you for your great word, your great grounding of truth that you have given us through the prophets of old. Lord, we pray that the words would not fall upon our deaf ears, but they would find fertile soil of our hearts to encourage and to strengthen and to move us outward for you. God, I ask for that this day for all of us. In your name, amen. We have community meal tonight, so take advantage of that or pass that on to someone you think could benefit from that. And also want to invite you back for worship on Sunday, both streaming as well as in person as we begin Lent. So I hope you'll join us, and I hope you have a good day, and also know that our Lenten Soup Suppers will begin next Wednesday on Zoom from 6 to 6:30. So have a good day, folks. God bless. Bye-bye now.